I would buy you a house. And if I had $1 million, if I had $1 million, I'd buy you furniture for that house, a camo recliner to watch the game. And if I had $1 million, if I had $1 million, I would buy you a Kia from that man sitting right over there. And if I had $1 million, I'd buy your love. If I had $1 million, I wouldn't have deer stand in our yard. If I had $1 million, short walk from the house wouldn't be that hard. If I had $1 million, and we could put a tiny little refrigerator in there somewhere.
Oh, yeah, maybe a deep fryer and a big screen.
Yeah, it wouldn't even have to be deer season. We could just, like, hang out up in the deer stand.
We can fry up any old thing we want.
You know, people fry Oreos and Snicker bars, but no one ever fries up celery. If I had $1 million, if I had $1 million, I would buy you a diamond ring and get a nice shotgun to boot. If I had $1 million, if I had $1 million, I would buy you an exotic pet, like a llama or a zebex. If I had $1 million, if I had $1 million,
I'd buy you tickets to a Razorback game.
Football or baseball, you pick.
If I had $1 million, I'd buy your love.
It hauls more.
If I had $1 million,
we'd get invited to more fundraisers.
Oh yeah, we have a nice salad.
Some stuffed chicken breast, glazed carrots,
steamed broccoli.
And all the donations we would make.
Oh yeah, I know, it'd be crazy.
Yeah.
It'd be wonderful. Let's see.
If I had $1 million,
if I had $1 million,
I would buy you a fast boat
and another for when we go tubing.
If I had $1 million,
if I had $1 million,
I would buy you a duck club.
We might even hunt some ducks.
If I had $1 million,
if I had $1 million,
I'd buy you awesome cars
from either Landers or from McLarty.
If I had $1 million, I'd buy your love.
If I had $1 million,
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 if I had $1 million.
John Eisner and Ed Lowry, everybody. Shh. This is where my homeschool mom comes out. Shh. I'll hush everybody. Hi, everybody. My name's Lisa Fisher. Thank you so much for being here tonight. I'm glad to represent this organization for a second year in a row. I'm a radio and TV personality in Little Rock. I'm old. I've been around a long time. So, yes, that was me on Dialing for Dollars in the 80s that your grandmother loved. Mm-hmm. They still stop me at the grocery store. Tuesdays is Senior Citizen Day at Kroger because they can still spot me as the girl that did Dialing for Dollars. So I just left radio and I was on B98.5 for 12 years and now I'm an empty nester having the best time. We stay up till like 11 o'clock watching objectionable shows like Netflix. And have y'all seen Ozark on Netflix? Oh, well, whew, breathe into a paper bag. So my life has changed a little bit. I'm writing for AY Magazine, and I host a YouTube channel. I've got a website, lisafishersaid.com. Go ahead. You've got phones. You can go ahead and look. I can go ahead and get those hits tonight. And thank you so much for having me. You know why you're here. And a few things we need to be reminded of. And one is our country's very divided now. Have you been on social media today? Well, let's find something we can agree on, and that is rehabilitating men and women who leave our prisons. Let's find them jobs. Let's educate them, okay? It's really important. Then we don't have to worry about what a Supreme Court justice, someone nominated for the Supreme Court justice, what he did or didn't do. Let's talk about educating these inmates and getting them jobs. And we're going to talk to Amanda Knight and hear from Amanda Knight, who's done that. We're going to talk to other people who have committed their lives to changing the future. I had a brother who was incarcerated, and he died 5 years ago in a house fire. He had to live at home with my parents because, you know, at 45 in Dermot, Arkansas, no one wanted to hire him. And that's what we're dealing with. And my brother was a nonviolent offender. He was a drug abuser and died an addict. So I have a really big heart for this group and what you do and what is being done, especially with the nonviolent offenders in our prison system. So I want to introduce you, our guests tonight, or a couple of our guests tonight. I was a young, impressionable journalism major at the University of Arkansas in the 80s, and I had a public relations course that Jess Covington was the professor, and he wanted to have Mack McLarty come speak to our class. Of course, then we knew him as the young man who at 23 was elected to the House of Representatives. We knew him as a University of Arkansas graduate. He was an honor graduate there. We knew a little bit about him, not, of course, what his career trajectory ended up doing. But I was so impressed with him that I wrote him a letter on 8.5 by 11 paper. I got my IBM Selectrad out and went, ta-da-da-da-da-da, hem, ta-da-da-da-da, hem. And I backspaced when I had a mistake and used my whiteout. And I wrote him a letter and thanked him for coming. And you know what he did? He wrote me a letter. He thanked me for my thank you note. Now, he was raised right. That's what happens when you're raised in Hope, Arkansas. He believed in a place called Hope. Of course, you know him as a man who has done so much in the community, in the state, in the world. Everything from, of course, his life in politics, working for some guy who got a job in the White House. He was the first, you know, he'd worked there. Of course, chief of staff, and the other things that Mack McLarty had done. And, of course, you might know his name in the front of auto groups. And we'll talk more about that tonight and what he's done with Mr. Landers. So the name Mack McLarty is synonymous with service in our community and in our on our planet. He knows Henry Kissinger, y'all, seriously. And, you know, down the political aisle, as to both presidents from both parties have relationships with him and appointed him to different things. So give a warm welcome to our guest tonight, Mack McLarty.
Good evening. Well, Lisa, first of all, thank you for a particularly warm and generous introduction. I greatly appreciate it. You were very kind to remember that time at the University of Arkansas. I think my mind went back to that class. I do remember with Dr. Covington speaking there. But more importantly, thank you really for all that you do for our community, for our state, and for our nation more broadly. You bring a spirit, which was evident in your comments, an elegance, a sense of caring, and I think your comments set the table just perfectly, perfectly for tonight's event. So thank you for your leadership, and keep your facilitative hand to keep our program moving. And thank each and every one of you for taking time out of your schedule to join us tonight to celebrate the important work of the 2018 Out of the Life Awards. I have been looking for a hometown crowd, and I think I may have just found one tonight. It's great to see so many friends of longstanding, and we're glad to have all of you here to support, as Lisa noted, such a meaningful, important, and indeed, noble and worthy cause. Many of us are gathered here tonight because we have had the opportunity to work in our community, whether it be in business or education, in public service or other endeavors. And I suspect everyone in this room is committed to improving the lives of our fellow Arkansans. But we're also here tonight because we all agree that that commitment should extend to everyone, including the thousands of Arkansans who are locked behind bars and who want to earnestly get their lives back on track to get on the right pathway. And as many of you know, our home state has far too high of repeat offender rates. Too often people are released only to reoffend and return. We need as a community to do all we can to help break that vicious cycle. I think it's fair to say we all believe in redemption, we believe in a second chance, and we know that some people can change and change for the better. We also know that the prison population here and around our country is growing, and there's not a moment to waste in terms of getting to work. And as Lisa already has noted and framed, that's exactly what the Exodus Project is focused to do. And it's vital, absolutely vital, to our state's future. I was visiting with Paul Stevens earlier. He and his team have delivered hope to hundreds of people who have been incarcerated and delivered hope to their families as well. And importantly, have given those people the skills and guidance that they need to be meaningful members of society. They get ahead of the curve in their efforts, and that's exactly the right thing to do. And their work takes some pressure off our overstressed criminal justice system. The work of Exodus is fortified by so many of you. I really found it meaningful and enjoyed talking to a number of you who have been involved in this work for a number of years. It's fortified by heroes in our community who employ our formerly incarcerated neighbors. So tonight, we'll have a chance to honor a number of people, and one of those honorees, my friend and colleague, Steve Landers. Steve, I'm particularly pleased to be here with you and Sandy and your family. And it's meaningful, I think, that you're following Congressman French Hill, who I think was the first recipient of the Exodus Award. And Martha, we're delighted to have you join us tonight as well. I'll have more to say about Mr. Landers in the future here. But for now, I'd like to invite to the stage to lead us in our invocation Dr. William Dubs Byers, who is pastor of the First Baptist Church in Dumas, and I might proudly add, a native of Hope, Arkansas. Reverend Byers.
May we pray. Father, we come to you tonight with thankful hearts, thankful for your bountiful blessings. God, we thank you that you're a God of second chances. And God, I'm so thankful for these men and women who work so diligently to bring about second chances for other people's lives. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. Thank you for Paul and the Exodus Project. We pray for them. Pray that they might be successful in their outreach efforts, and God, we thank you for all that you give to us, especially for this food tonight. We pray your blessings upon it. I pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Okay, I'm back. Look at this attractive man behind me, sitting right to my front. There's a book written about him. I have it beside my bedside table, and I've been reading it, and it is for sale tonight. And, of course, the proceeds go to the Exodus Project, A reminder for those of you accountants in the room, it is a 501c3 corporation, fully tax deductible and recognized by the Internal Revenue Service. I've had to say that before. So get a book about Steve Landers. You will enjoy that. Let me tell you a couple of other things. There are vases on your table, the blown glass. There are awards here by the famous James Hayes of Pine Bluff. He did these for us tonight, and they are, you can have them. Only one person per table can grab one. They are $150. There are donor cards in front of them, and whichever woman grabs it first and gets it, she can run out of here with a James Hayes glass vase, and I think you'll like them because these are beautiful. He does amazing work. I need to recognize Rob tonight. Where's Rob? There he is. Rob Talley and One Source Events helped Allison Johnson with this. Now, the sisters in the room are going to appreciate. The men are going to go, you mean this costs something? It costs a lot of money to put on these events, and they did it for the low, low price of free, in that the tablecloths and the napkins, everything has been borrowed, and they promised to take it back to whoever the original owners are. Even the orchids, please don't touch them. They're fake. The vases are real. They had to glue them with some type of NASA super glue yesterday. I was here and watched that. But they did that because when you give to an organization like the Exodus Project, you know that your money is going to educate these young men and women who are leaving incarceration, is going to give them, if you've ever been, have you ever been, Steve and I talked about this the other day, you've been to the graduation, right? Yeah, I saw Steve at lunch the other day. Graduation's impressive, y'all, for the Exodus Project. If you leave there with a dry eye, check your pulse, because you see men and women whose lives have been changed, and you also see the racial divide, that it is mostly a white population that's sent as nonviolent offenders. There were, I think, two African-Americans last year. Maybe one, Allison. Was it one or two in my group last year? Maybe one or two. But I was able to speak to them last year. But go sometime. Ask Allison or the people here if you can go to one of the graduations and see what they do. And you see what Kathy and all the volunteers do. They give so much time, because they want to change that generation and break the cycle. That's why I love this group. So no money was spent. Have I done everything, Allison? Rob, the vases, the book. Okay, now you get to watch moving pictures. We have a video tonight Allison was a part of. She said after this, she's going to hang up her hat and run away from here, but we're going to make her stay. Video that was done, and we have more to entertain you tonight, but sit back and enjoy this.
Bow our heads, please. Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful day to join here and celebrate the conclusion of one journey that will guide us on our next journey. Father, we thank you for gathering these good people together and creating the Exodus Project for us. Please guide us now through the celebration and then through this day.
Amen. My name is Paul Stevens. I'm the executive director of the Exodus Project. It's amazing to me in a state as small as ours that we have put as many of our people in prison as we have. I think as a society, we need to face the fact that we have embarked on a path that will not work. What are we trying to accomplish? Is it simply punishment? Is it rehabilitation? Good, healthy, open discussion about these things is long overdue.
Okay. What we're going to do in this class and in the Exodus Academy is give you guys the tools. But what I can't do is make you put it in your heart. I can't give you the drive to use your tools. Only you can do that.
My name is Kathy McConnell. I am an instructor at the Exodus Project. The average person that I teach is an addict. They're young. This is maybe the first time they've been in prison. Young men who want to make a change in their lives.
We get caught in the helpless trap when we think and act like we are victims of circumstance and there's nothing we can do to solve our problems.
Anybody ever use that?
Yeah. When I seen my father get shot and killed, I tried to use drugs to hide that pain, to take away that pain. In the long run, it really didn't do nothing but cause me pain.
They see me as stern. I'm old school. Look at me. I'm old school. I taught high school English for many years. I don't put up with anything. But they also know that I'm stern, but I care about them. I don't judge them. And if they're willing to work, I'm willing to walk beside them.
The Exodus Project is an educational experience designed for men and women in prison just prior to their release. The curriculum is specifically designed to build in the capacity to change. It's as if you're watching transformation take place in front of your very eyes. Now, that transformation doesn't assure that they won't make a mistake again, that they won't relapse or maybe even recidivate, but it certainly creates the possibility, the potential for a better future, and that's very exciting.
What you see are gifted individuals. Yes, their past is real. What they've done is real, and they're being incarcerated for those reasons. But that doesn't define who they are. And the Exodus Project is giving people hope to realize they can be more than that sliver of their past.
Now, there are many, many people in prison, and I'm really glad some of them are there. But on the other hand, there's a very large portion of people who simply need a second chance. And they need the support and the encouragement, the resources that anyone needs when they embark on change. Change is difficult, but it happens all the time.
Being an addict isn't a moral failing. It has to do with your brain being hijacked. So I knew that when I got out, if I was having a hard time, I could go to somebody and ask for help, and that I wouldn't be ashamed of it or scared of it.
Well, I know with me, support's everything when it comes to recovery, because nobody can recover on their own. Exodus taught me that there are people out there that care and want to see you succeed in life.
You know, guys, you're all adult men, but here's the issue. Y'all have numbed your feelings for so long. So what we're dealing with here is you're gonna have a bundle of nerves and feelings, and only when you get them out, really, and deal with them, can they be gone.
We cannot keep building prisons. We cannot continue to have the violence. Opiate overdoses are the number one cause of death of people under 50 in the United States. We cannot continue this. We have to do something, and we're doing something.
In my addiction, I didn't care whether or not I lived or died. You know, when you're to that point of shooting up, you know, heroin or fentanyl into your arms, when you're searching out, you know, I might have heard, you know, so-and-so overdosed on this drug yesterday. So I would go and seek out, you know, where did they get it from? You know, my life didn't matter to me. It mattered to my family, it mattered to my children and my loved ones, but it didn't matter to me. It's safe to say that there's a good chance that Exodus probably did and has saved my life.
In the social sector, partnerships are critical for success because the problems are too large. They're too big for any one organization or any one philosophy to be able to address.
Tara is an example of an individual who, having served her sentence, had the opportunity to be connected with us through the Exodus Project. And she went through our TEO program, which is our Transitional Employment Opportunities Program. We saw such a transformation and an opportunity with Tara that Tara not only is a graduate of the program, but now is an employee.
It's our obligation to bring population that are coming out of incarceration, to get them jobs, to get them connected back to the community, and let other people in the community know that these are good folks that may have made a mistake and are ready to move on and do life again. Nobody's their own success. Everybody has somebody, somewhere, something that played into their story.
There's a stigma on addicts, you know, that we can't do anything, that nobody wants to hire us. You know, I think it's important that the community comes together to see and realize that these people, including myself, need help.
You know, we have different seasons in our life, and I'm at a season in my life where I get to do what I want to do, and how fortunate I am that I have found this to do. I love it. I get to go in every day and actually try to make a difference in someone's life.
Well, the day is here where we take what we have learned and apply it to our daily lives. I've learned that when you're serious about change, you don't need a new year. All you need is a new moment.
They gave me hope, they accepted me for who I was, and they gave me the foundation that I needed to build on to have a sober, successful, and free living life.
I needed somebody. I needed somebody to show me the way, and that's exactly what happened. And since I've been released, I've just kind of been walking that same path that was taught to me and succeeding.
Powerful, isn't it, when you see a changed life? And that's what this group does. They're in the business of changing the future for these young men and women, so many of them. It's funny, last year when I went to that graduation, I spoke, and then I was in the back, and a man came up. There were maybe 15 or so that were graduating, and he introduced himself because I was in radio, and he introduced me and himself as someone who I knew from radio. And he just came on hard times and had battled addiction, and there he was, somebody who I respected that was at one of the competing radio stations. And I just shook my head, and just it reminded me that this could be anybody. That's our mother, brother, sister, father, child. It could be anybody. And we would want the help for any of those people. Now, I want to introduce you, my friend, right now. If you've been watching Channel 11, you see her beautiful face in the mornings. And you might know that she won an Emmy over the weekend for something THV 11 did on the opioid crisis. Laura Monteverdi, she's important to me because we share a hairdresser, the most important person on the planet. But she also, we had her at our home a couple of years ago for Thanksgiving. And yeah, everyone noticed her. She's a cutie. You won't miss that. But she has a message to share. And she boldly tells something. The thing about addiction, as we know, and if you don't, you haven't really been around anyone, it's the shame that's involved, which is... I shake my head and go, let's banish the shame and let's head on. You know, whatever words I'm trying to say. But let's confront it and then let's deal with it. And Laura has boldly done that with her message. So I'm very proud of her. She's our speaker tonight. She's up. You think I got up early in the morning. I got up like at 3:30. She gets up like yesterday. Are you going to get up in a few hours and be on the air? You get up at 2:45. She sleeps until 2:45. That's if she's already had a blowout and her hair looks good, right? And your fake eyelashes are on? Okay. Let me introduce my friend, Laura Monteverdi, everybody.
No one will ever have hair as good as Lisa Fisher. The blowout does look good. Thank you all so much for having me here tonight. It is truly an honor to be here. I'll be honest, I was talking with Paul about this just a few minutes ago. A year ago, I had no idea what the Exodus Project was. In fact, I didn't know many people who had struggled with addiction. I didn't know anyone in jail or anyone that had lost a loved one to an overdose. That is until I decided to share my personal story. 3 years ago, I lost the love of my life to a heroin overdose. Brock was 26 years old. And my world truly ended that day. At least I felt like it did. And a lot of you who have lost a loved one, especially to an overdose, know exactly how that feels. For 2.5 years, I didn't talk about how Brock died. And it wasn't because I was worried about what people would think of me. I was worried that they would judge him. They would say cruel things about him. So instead of talking about it, I just stayed quiet. But when I did decide to open up, it was in that, you know, little news documentary I did, some of you have seen here tonight, that I started to live again. I met countless people whose lives have been touched by addiction. Sharing my story brought me here to the Exodus Project. In the last few months, I have met some amazing people who dedicate their lives to this organization. Mandy, wherever you are, I heard your story for the first time the other day, and to see your tears and hear your testimony just blew me away. It was incredible, and I know that it is changing lives. And Paul, make you cry, because you make everybody cry. When you speak about this organization, it comes straight from your heart, and everybody feels it. They feel your passion. Thank you for what you do. And Mallory, you are the person who introduced me to this organization. I'm so thankful. Your passion for what you do is incredible. I know that you've had a rocky past, but you are using your past to change lives. And I just love you. I'm so glad that I met you and you introduced me to this organization. In the past few weeks, I've had the opportunity to meet some of the young men that are in the Exodus Project right now. And to be honest, it's a little intimidating. I come off the desk in my dress and heels, and I walk into a room with a bunch of men in brown uniforms and tattoos. It's a little intimidating, but it only takes minutes, and the barriers just fall. Going around the room and hearing their testimony, you can't help but feel changed, just like you do when you see that video. One of them said the other day, "I feel like I failed. I lost everything, my kids, my family, my house. How am I supposed to inspire people?" And I just shook my head and I said, just by doing that, admitting that you are at the bottom and you are doing everything you can to change that and change your life for the better. And that is what Exodus does. It gives hope to those who need it most, including myself. I won't ever know why Brock picked up a needle that day, why he chose to use after 8 years of being sober. But through these men and women I've met at Exodus, I feel like I'm able to see through Brock's eyes a little bit, understand his struggle, why he used, why this addiction was so much bigger than him. Brock is no longer here, but these men and women have been given a chance to take their lives back. And with the Exodus Project, they are doing just that. No longer are they the scary men in the brown uniforms with the tattoos. No longer are they the addicts or junkies that society has labeled them. No longer are they defined by our past. Like Lisa said, they are our brothers, our sisters, our sons, our daughters. And I truly pray that one day all of society recognizes that. And it's programs like Exodus that not only saves lives, but changes them too. And I'm so honored to be here tonight, and somehow, if I can, play a small role in sending that message using the platform that I have. Thank you for all that you do and for everyone that supports this incredible organization. I'm proud to be a part of it in some small way. Thank you.
You know, Laura touched on what I said earlier. It was the shame. Isn't that interesting that the shame, just not for the addict, but for those of us, family members, friends, loved ones, we also feel the shame. It's such a lie, because it's just like anything else. We need to support each other, and that's what the Exodus Project does. That's why Paul Stevens has committed his life to doing that. I want to introduce to you him now so that you can meet him. If you haven't met him, you think, I've got energy. Huh, he's got me beat. And especially he has a lot of energy when it talks about changing lives. He and I were we in community group together? Is that how we met? Where is he? Sharefest, that's right. In the 90s, back when the earth cooled, like a long time ago. Yeah. I used to be a young girl. I was really cute then. Anyway, I was this young, cute girl, and we were with Fellowship Bible Church doing some charitable missions, and that's when I saw Paul's heart for those less fortunate, and I knew he was the real deal. And if you've ever worked with him, you know that. If you've worked with the Exodus Project long, you know that he wants to be able to get the message out, and he loves that you're here tonight. If you're a guest of somebody, I hope you remember that and consider that, and you'll be generous tonight. And whether it's the vase on your table or it's one of the donor cards on your table, that you'll be generous with this group because they need your help, and go to a graduation. But let me introduce you, Paul Stevens, everybody.
Lisa, I don't know who told you you stopped being beautiful, but we need to find them and correct that problem. We really do. Thanks a lot. And thanks for the other guests who said kind things. This is really not about me tonight, so I'm only going to be taking a minute or two. But there are a couple things I want to say. You know, the Out for Life Award, when we came up with it and we're discussing it, really is about acknowledging collaborative leadership. And the reason I say that, and I want to highlight it, is most of the social problems that we face are too big. They're too big for any one sector of society or organization to address. There are 20,000 men and women in prison right now. 10,000 will be released this coming year and be in our communities. That's a lot of people. And to see them change really requires relationship. There's not a cookie-cutter solution or a programmatic solution. The solution is really life on life. And so it's a very difficult problem. And so even as I'm going to give a couple of awards to our graduate of the year and to one of our volunteers, there are other organizations that are represented out here that were critical to their success. Kim with Hope Rises, I don't know where you guys are, but wave at least. We also have representatives from Goodwill, I think, are here. Brian, are you guys around? Yeah. Our House, I think, sent a couple of representatives. Yeah. And those are just a few. We also have a number of representatives from Arkansas Community Corrections, which is the state side of our partnership. And without them, we wouldn't have access to the inmates, and so we couldn't do what we do. So it's people working together. And so to highlight that, one of the things Exodus does is we're volunteer-driven. I have 4 staff people. We have campuses in West Memphis and here in Little Rock and hopefully soon in Osceola and in Malvern. But we're able to do that because we rely on volunteers to do the instruction, people coming from the community with expertise. And the impact on the inmates is amazing because they're going, okay, you could be making money, having lunch, doing anything, but instead you're down here with me. And they have that for 12 weeks. And so after 12 weeks, you get to know each other. You have an impact, and all of a sudden it becomes life on life. I had one particular volunteer that I want to ask to come up that has had a wonderful year. This gentleman is a leader in our community. I remember when we started out at Arkansas Baptist, I actually knew Eric and invited him to come and join our staff of volunteer instructors. And Eric, if you know Eric, and Eric, you might as well head this way. You can't hide. Would you welcome Sheriff-elect Eric Higgins. I'm afraid you didn't change, man.
Well, I was tempted not to.
Eric and I have known each other for some years, and so I began talking to him about coming in and teaching some of our classes. We were at Arkansas Baptist, where he was an adjunct professor. And in his kind of quiet, stern way, he was very, very, very unwilling. And finally, he looked at me and he said, Stevens, I was with the Little Rock Police Department for 30 years. I've probably arrested 2/3 of those guys. You think they're going to want me to be their teacher? But I finally talked him into it, and over the last 3 years, he has become the most beloved instructor, along with Miss Kathy, who you saw in the video, that we've had. And it's really made me mad, because I was supposed to be most popular, and I'm not.
You're still the most popular.
Yeah, no, I'm not. But Eric, I have the right one here? We want to present to you, isn't this beautiful? Can you see it? the Out for Life Award, volunteer award for this year, and thank you for your leadership.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. One of the hidden effects of the Exodus Project is not just the inmates, it's families. We get to see families reunited, and it is so much fun. And so we have a graduate who's going to come up. You saw her in the video. She is Tara. Tara, why don't you come on up? I told your daughter I was going to make her come up, but I don't think she's listened to me. I think she hid. Tara has been a graduate for 2 years, a little over 2 years. Yeah. And she came in class and was pretty quiet and pretty reserved and really didn't know how she was going to do. But what we discovered was this girl was on a mission. She was not going back to jail. She was not getting back in the life that she had been in before, and it didn't matter. She was gonna make it work. And so she went to Hope Rises and their program on her release. And Kim Roxborough has a wonderful women's program there that's really tailored specifically to a woman's needs. Hooked up with Goodwill CEO program. And now, are you the director of the reentry program, assistant director, somewhere in there?
No. Yeah. I'm just the TEO coordinator.
Just the TEO coordinator, right. So you're coordinating what you used to learn from.
Yes.
Tara's reunited with her daughter, even though she's hiding. And she has a life now. And that's what Exodus is really about. So congratulations, Tara.
Thank you.
The Taras, and by the way, if you see anyone with an Exodus badge on, they're probably a graduate. But it's the redemption of those lives that's required the efforts of a lot of people, a lot of you. And we just want to encourage the business community. We need your help. These men and women need jobs. And I hope you'll think about that as our program continues.
Oh, man, Gary has quite a task for us.
Oh, what's that?
He wants us to come up with a new ad campaign for Steve Lander.
What? Gary and GWL have been a big part of Steve's ad campaigns for years.
I know.
And Gary's trusting us to come up with something.
Yeah, and that's why we need something fresh. We need something new. We need something that nobody's ever seen from Steve Lander's before.
And why is it that we need to come up with this new campaign?
What do you mean?
I mean, why is it that we're coming up with this fresh, new idea?
Because that's why they hired us.
And who hired us, exactly?
Steve Landers.
So, basically, what you're saying is that we're coming up with this new idea because...
That's what Steve said.
Yes!
Why did I bring you in on this?
Because I am an idea machine. Yeah. And you know what they say in brainstorming? There are no bad ideas.
Nope, just bad people.
What's that?
Nothing. So, this is why we need a new campaign.
Right. Thoughts?
You're the idea machine.
Right. Ooh, what if we had a baby pool?
Baby pool?
Yeah. No, it was going to be a pun about how he sells cars, not boats, because cars go on land, and he's Landers. I'll keep thinking.
Great.
Oh, what if we did a sort of an Evel Knievel kind of thing, only instead it's Steve.
No.
Right. Okay. I have an idea. Listen to this.
I'm listening.
All right. So there was this guy, right? And he, Steve hired him to work at one of his dealerships.
Okay.
Yeah. And so it turns out the guy had a record.
Oh, he's a singer. So you want him to do like a show tune?
No. He didn't cut a record. He had a record, like he'd done time.
Like in prison?
Yeah.
Well, and Steve didn't know this.
No, I think Steve knew it.
I don't know where you're going with this.
Well, the guy, you know, he struggled at first. Steve just kind of kept supporting him and helping him make his way. And then finally, you know, the guy was like, you know, I have a real opportunity here.
An opportunity to...
You know, to take advantage.
Take advantage.
Yeah, and really work hard for Steve.
Work hard for Steve?
Yeah. And he did. In fact, I think he climbed up in the dealership. Maybe even became like a manager or something.
Manager?
Yeah.
So?
What?
Well, where's the punchline, man? Where's the joke, the laugh?
Well, there's no punchline. That's just reality. It's what happened.
It's what happened?
Yeah. Oh, and then there was the famous story about the teacher. That, like, back in, when Steve was in high school, this teacher told him that he wouldn't amount to anything. And then later on, when his company got big, she came in and apologized, right? And Steve forgave her, told her thank you for, like, helping him reevaluate, and then he gave her a really good deal on a car.
The teacher?
Yeah. Oh, and then there's the homeless guy who came in and wanted to sweep up around the shop, and Steve, like, gave him a job, you know? Just the facts.
The facts?
Yeah.
Bob, we're not interested in facts. We're in advertising.
Yeah, but why do we just want to sell cars?
Because we're an ad agency.
Yeah, but cars, they come and go. I mean, they change the styles, they change the names, they're always adding new features.
That's right, and every time they do, we want people to buy a new one.
Yeah, and that's why we don't need to sell the cars. We need to sell the guy. The guy they're going to come back to every time to buy the car.
The guy.
Yeah, the guy, the real guy. The guy who cares about real people with real problems, you know? The homeless guy who needs a job. The parolee who's trying to rebuild his life. The teacher who wound up becoming a good customer of his, by the way. The 20-something punk who came in thinking he knew all about how to buy a new car and wanted the fresh new thing. And Steve kind of sat him down, man to man. Helped him, you know, evaluate his finances, figure out what he could actually afford.
Wait. Did you buy a car from Steve Landers in your 20s?
No, I didn't.
I'm so confused.
Steve, he called this other guy. It was a guy who used to work for him, but he'd gone out on his own, started a new little used car dealership.
Uh-huh.
Said, hey, I got a young man here who needs a car. Maybe you can help him out. So in a way, he was kind of helping out both of us at the same time. That's the Steve Landers I know.
So you want to develop an ad campaign that helps Steve sell cars,
uh-huh,
with a story about Steve not selling you a car?
Yeah.
And about a teacher and some homeless guy and a parolee?
Well, yeah. I mean, I think there are some good stories out there to tell about people who are where they are today because a car salesman from Benton, Arkansas, whose name's on dealerships all over the country, gave those individuals a second chance.
And what would the tagline for this campaign be?
How about, that's what Steve does? Hmm. What do you think?
I think you're out of your mind.
Huh?
Yeah, we're about selling cars. This is 2018, everything's virtual now. Wait, and you want to talk about real people? Real people, not selling cars, not the latest gadget or the power this, power that. You're ridiculous.
Maybe I just wanted to say thanks, Steve.
Innovative sales approach, location savvy, an eye for profitability, customer minded. All these would be great ways to describe Steve Landers when he was 5 years old. The more things change, the more they stay the same. At five, Steve began his sales career selling the Benton Courier. He'd buy copies in bulk for 3 cents apiece, then sell them for 5 cents at his corner, Richards and South Street, a prime location that also happened to be a few doors from home. His education in buying, selling, and swapping continued under the guidance of Granddad, who took him to livestock sales and wholesale auto auctions. Steve began his own work in the auto industry at age 14, washing cars at a dealership. In his late teens, two important moments came for Steve. First, he graduated high school, but just barely. Steve had gained a reputation with teachers, and one spoke up to him at graduation, telling him he would never amount to anything. This became a pivotal moment. Instead of feeling victimized or simply dismissing her words, Steve heard that teacher's comment and made it his launching pad. The other very important moment was when Steve entered into the longest-lasting partnership of his life by proposing to his high school sweetheart, Sandy. Steve acquired his legal permit to sell cars at the age of 17 and hit the ground running, soon becoming a top salesman for the dealership where he worked. Then in 1972, when Steve was only 19, he and his father, Bob, purchased a used car dealership in Benton. The Landers auto empire had begun. Over the next 17 years, the Landers built the business on principles of high-volume sales of quality vehicles. By the late 1980s, they had attracted the attention of the Chrysler Corporation, and in 1989, they would be awarded with a standalone Jeep Eagle dealership. They only grew from there, adding dealerships and setting national sales records from a strip of I-30 in Benton, Arkansas. After years of success, Steve Landers sold his dealerships to United Auto Group, now Penske Automotive Group, in 1997, becoming head of the company's South Central region, which oversaw operations in five states. Providing high-level leadership to one of the largest auto groups in the nation was fast-paced, exciting work, but also meant many nights away from home. Based on an agreement with Roger Penske, Steve purchased a Toyota dealership in Little Rock to get back into local business, but that didn't mean slowing down. Steve and his sons took the Toyota dealership and built a new state-of-the-art facility, which quickly grew to leading in Toyota sales in the state. In 2004, Steve Landers formed a partnership with Robert Johnson and Mack McLarty, creating RJL McLarty Landers Automotive and running the company as president. The auto group became one of the best performing dealership groups in the nation. Landers retired as president in 2012 to be a member of the advisory board and joined forces with his son to create the new family of Steve Landers dealerships. Now the Steve Landers stores are some of the highest grossing in the region as part of the Luther Automotive Group, with dealerships remaining under the control of the Landers family. And Steve, in retirement, can still frequently be found at the dealership, doing what he has always done best.
Jumped the gun there, sorry. I was so excited. I was watching John Eisner, though, and Ed Lowery, and I know the Mangan Holcomb group over there is going, that is not how advertisers do that. So good job on your advertising marketing. And of course, now we need to introduce Pete Hornibrook. He's going to introduce to you Steve Landers for tonight. Pete is the former chairman, CEO of the RPM group. He will be giving our introductory speech of the man of the evening. That is Steve Landers.
Thank y'all. It's quite an honor to be a part of this wonderful project and program that presented today, tonight. It's going to be a great pleasure to take part in honoring my good friend Steve Landers and his family, Sandy and Stevie and your family, and Scott and yours. I must be honest about this. When Angela Rhodes, well, Paul had called me. I didn't know Paul from Adam. And I said, yeah, I'll meet with you. I knew, you know, probably want to raise a little money or something, especially since they offered to buy my breakfast. Well, I'm an oatmeal guy, so it didn't cost me but a cup of coffee. But then they got to talking about the program. I'm very familiar with the addiction, different programs around our community, and I was very interested, but non-committal. But then I thought, well, you know, this could be payback time. Yeah. So I happened to be having lunch with Steve, and afterwards I said, Steve, are you ready for this? And he said, what are you talking about? And I said, well, they're gonna talk about you. And he said, he busted my balloon right there. He said, Pete, this is not a roast. So I thought about that, and I want to at least take a moment to tell you a personal story of why I would have thought how nice a roast would have been. We all know Steve is the greatest motivator there is, the best salesman in the world. He also takes great pride in being a locker room pep talker. I think he's done that many times at Plastic Academy and several other places. So one day we were talking and I said, well, Steve, you're so good at this. Why don't you come to one of my or our RPM sales meeting and give them a little bit of that spirit? And he said, you know, I'd like to do that. But you know, I usually charge for that. He said, but for you, Pete, I'll do it for free. Now remember, he said free. So I pick him up one day, we go to the sales meeting. He puts this fabulous, inspirational, motivational speech on them. He's got them all revved up. And, you know, they're just on the edge of their seat. And so am I. And rightfully so, because he turns and he says, and Pete has authorized me to share with you their contest that they're fixing to have. And my mouth dropped out as he pointed out that the winner of the year of production first prize would be $10,000. Not only that, the second place would get $5,000 and third $3,000. I'm not a mental giant, but I figured out quite quickly that that was going to have to change the budget to $18,000. But it did work out. At the end of the year, everything worked. And he was right again. I think of how fitting this venue would be about a second chance. Life is all about a second chance. As we all know, Steve has worked hard all his life selling cars, motivating others to achieve success in life. He's provided for his family in so many ways. But you know, with that comes sacrifice. Steve and his family have made many, many sacrifices. It entails being away from home. It entails being away from family projects and functions and seeing children do things. So although when he was home, I think he did his best to attend all the ball games and coach his sons, which were great athletes. But that taken away from family time is a sacrifice. So now semi-retired, Steve has expressed many times how wonderful it is to have that second chance to be with his family. He knows that family is what it's all about. To be a part of the functions and activities of the young ones, grandchildren are here tonight. I know they are here tonight to applaud their big papa. That's what they call him. Steve loves his wife, his boys, Stevie and Scott. He's so proud of their accomplishments and their achievements. He's a good friend. He has helped so many people, as they've demonstrated tonight, more than most would ever know. We all know how successful he is. Well, why is that? Steve's all about positive thinking. He is very, very trustworthy. I trust him with my life. He's willing, always been willing, to do what others are not willing to do to be successful. He's all about helping others and building lasting relationships. He's cut from a cloth I'm familiar with, my dad always said and taught us, as his dad taught him, your word is your bond. I've known Steve a long time and had a lot of interactions with Steve. I've never known him to worry about what he said because he has told the truth and he doesn't have to worry about that. So if he tells you something, you can count on it. As I've said, Steve has given back and given second chances many times over, by which you've heard it's been demonstrated tonight. What an honor it is for me tonight to congratulate you, Steve, and your family, and I love y'all. Thank you for allowing me to share.
Pete, your remarks were absolutely on the mark. You've been a great friend, not only to Steve and Sandy, but the entire Landers family. And I can just see Steve getting that honorarium in the manner that he did with your sales force there. This has been a full evening, and my comments, as I have the privilege to present this award to Steve, will be brief. It's been an evening that has struck me with a range of emotions. It's touched our hearts. It's had sadness. It's had joy. It's had emotion. So I think it is proper to end on a celebratory, upbeat, positive message to put just the right, hopefully, exclamation point at the conclusion of a wonderful and a meaningful and important evening. I've had the privilege to know Steve Landers, not just as a longtime friend, but as a competitor, and in more recent years, a business partner. And as you've already heard, both on the video and Pete and others have said, with Steve, you get the most powerful salesperson that I have ever known, perhaps save my father. And that's a high compliment, Steve, I assure you. But you also get a very shrewd, skilled, thoughtful business leader. Nobody outworks Steve, and very few, if any, outthink Steve Landers. You've already heard on the video he got to start washing cars at 14 and started selling cars at 17. He'd come early and stay late, and he would engage with those customers in the service line and on the lot, establish a relationship, and sell them a car or truck pretty soon. He is living proof that hard work is indeed the ticket to success. He brings a real passion, as all of you know, to what he does. Steve Landers is a force, a true force. And my point is, I think Steve understands better than most of us that every Arkansan deserves that opportunity to work hard just like he has and improve their lives, regardless of their background or circumstance. And you heard that in the skit that was put forth earlier this evening. Steve is the man today because he has worked hard, but he needed some cleaning supplies before he could wash those cars. He needed a little support from his father to get his first dealership started. And he needed support from his customers that would give him a little time to sell him that car or truck. So Steve, I think, understands extending that opportunity to others who need it most. And for over four decades, as you've heard in the car business, Steve and his family and Scott and Steve Jr. here with their families, the Landers have provided tens of thousands of Arkansans jobs, and some of whom were formerly incarcerated and needed that second chance. Unfortunately, there are some businesses today that won't even consider hiring someone that has been incarcerated. And that contributes to the vicious cycle that we've heard about, that Paul and others have spoke so thoughtfully and sincerely about. But by opening that door and inviting their time and talent to be part of your organization, Steve is not only doing the right thing, the ethical thing, he's doing the smart thing and a smart business decision. And my point is that really reflects, truly reflects, the broader trend of Steve's generosity in his career. Steve doesn't only deal in cars and trucks. Steve Landers deals in opportunities and big ideas. And he and his wife, Sandy, always take time to give back to the community that has meant so much to them. From the Landers Award to a strong investment commitment to diabetes and care, to natural disasters in their church, Emmanuel Baptist Church, and the list could go on and on. And Scott and Steve Jr. are following right in that tradition. And Sandy, it's meant a lot to Donna and me to have both you and Steve as friends, and we want you to know that. You've always been there for us, and that's meant a great deal. So in all of those ways, I think Steve's life and his career reinforces, it seems to me, Paul, the same values that the Exodus Project has of hard work and a helping hand. So I'll close with two quick anecdotes and stories, and let me assure you, there are a lot of Steve Landers stories, but I will only tell two very quickly. The first is Steve and I were working with our older son, Mark, and Steve has been a mentor not only to Steve Jr. and to Scott, but to our two sons, Mark and Franklin. We were contemplating this venture in China. It was a big opportunity. So we had this conference call, and we were thinking about ways we were going to present ourselves to the investors that were going to join us in this venture. And I said, well, Steve, that'll be pretty simple. I think we'll just present you as the largest Chrysler dealer in the United States. And there was this pause on the conference call, kind of a silence there. And Steve said, Mac, I think it's the largest in the world. I think that's right. So we used the largest in the world, and it worked out pretty good, I think. The second one, Denny Rogers, is here from Shreveport, who started with Steve many years ago, has been a great partner of all of us here. And when we first started, Steve will remember, he kept talking about building these bridges. We had to build a little bridge to get to the next passage in our endeavor. Steve was always saying, would you help me build that bridge? We got to build a bridge. Well, somehow, Steve, we always built that bridge. And my point is tonight is both of those approaches, hard work and a helping hand, and building that bridge, that pathway for a second chance and an opportunity, they both exemplify Steve Landers. And they both, to me, exemplify what the Exodus Project is really all about. So with that said, it is my privilege to present Steve Landers with the Exodus Project 2018 Out of Life Award. Steve, come on up here. Got it? All right, got it? All right, I'm gonna go behind you.
All right, I'm coming over here.
Steve's not gonna miss any opportunity. We'll be sure we got a picture here.
For all these years, I get stuck following Mac, and it's the worst thing you could ever do. He's the ultimate speaker and friend, and I always hate to follow him because it makes me look so bad, you know. I don't speak quite as elegant as mine. I didn't grow up in Hope, Arkansas. I grew up in Killeen County, you know. Anyway, thank y'all for coming tonight, and this is something that's deep to my heart and Sandy's and our families. And this is not about me tonight. This is about giving a second chance to people that might not otherwise get one. I believe in second chances. I've had second chances. A lot of us in this room have had second chances. And these guys and women can have come from great families. It's not anything. There's no economic place you've got to be incarcerated or to be on drugs or to have problems. You know, problems. I found it. I used to have sales meetings and I'd say, is anybody in here not having a, they don't have any problems around your house or home? And I never could get anybody to raise their hand so they didn't have any. So most people have problems. Our job is to, when they come to our stores, is to not cause another problem by having their car not ready or whatever, you know, because they have enough problems as they go along. Anyway, so I challenge, I've got some guys that are here tonight. Buddy, raise your hand. Buddy, come on up. Danny here. Danny, come up here with him. These are a couple of guys that worked for us for a long time, okay? Buddy Jordan and Danny Armstrong. Buddy, stand right here just for a minute. Come up here, Danny. These guys came to work for us. I used to sell Buddy cars before he got incarcerated, okay? And Danny came to work for us as a cleanup guy, cleaning, washing cars. And Danny, I'm going to start with Danny. Danny first came to us, and he worked for Stevie for how long, Stevie? A couple of years, maybe, cleaning cars. And he did a great job for us and showed that eagerness to want out of what he was in. And so we gave him a job. Stevie and him gave him a job selling cars. We gave him a job selling. Now, we got a guy that's been incarcerated for how many years, Danny?
17 years.
17 years. Okay? And he comes out, and now he's... How long have you been with us, Danny? 15 years? 15 years. He's worked for us 15 years. Comes to work every day, takes care of his business, pays his taxes, supports his family, and is there all the time. If everybody that worked there had the work ethics of him, we would be, it'd be really great. Buddy, another case. Buddy, Buddy comes in, been in prison. How long, Buddy? Were you in prison? How many?
6 years.
He was in prison 6 years. He comes out. Buddy's worked for us since he's been out. I guess how long you worked? 10 years, Buddy?
Yes.
10 years. And he's a manager now at one of our stores. His wife and him have stayed married through his incarceration. He does a great job, manages for us. These two guys are what we wish could happen with a lot of other people coming out. So I just wanted to show you that it really works. And these are just a couple of the guys. We've got several of them. These are just a couple of the guys. But I could pick the phone up and call either one of them right now and say, I need you. And they'd be at my house in 5 seconds, you know, because I supported them when their chips were down, you know. And now, in turn, they would do whatever for me. So thank you guys for coming tonight. You know, I want to thank my wife and my family for being here coming too. I really appreciate that because they mean the most to me. And I want to thank y'all for coming. Love y'all. So anyway, the 21,000 people next year will be incarcerated in the state of Arkansas. 21,000. 10,000 will come out, 11,000 will go in, you know? And so we've got to work on that. We've got to break that chain of what's happening. We've got to break that chain, you know? We've got to give them, these guys come out and work, and these guys pay taxes, and these guys take care of their families now, and they live life at the fullest, okay? So, you know, once broken, but now mended. You know, once broken, but now mended. Okay, so there it is there. And I challenge all these, you guys that's got businesses to give these guys a chance. And what I'd like to do before we leave is get everybody in here to go through your closet this week and try to help take some clothes that are nice clothes that maybe don't fit anymore and take them to the Toyota store out on Colonel Glenn. Take them to Steve Lander's Toyota. We'll get them all clean. We'll get them all pressed. And we'll get them where they can go in and apply for a job. So I know everybody. I know everybody in here has got clothes. I look at my closet all the time and say, man, I got to get rid of some of this stuff. You know? And so everybody grab 3 or 4 pantsuits or dress suits for women and guys. And drop them off at Steve Lander's Toyota. We'll have an outlet there, a box to put them in, and we will take them all out, get them clean, and we'll get them back to Allison, and she can distribute them to people that are going out to try to get in the workforce today. So y'all do that for sure this week. It doesn't take any time at all. And it's not anything, you know, because you're not wearing them anyway. And so anyway, let's do that if we can. I think that'd be great to get us started. And that's about all I got. Denny, I want to thank you for driving up from Shreveport, Bossier. And I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. I want to thank, again, this is not about me. I just happen to be the one that they could put it up here tonight. But this is about taking care of people that can't take care of themselves. I've always been that guy. I mean, I really have. If somebody can't take care of themselves, I'm going to try to help them, you know. I used to have this lady, she'd come by the store out there every day. I mean, every week, she'd want $20. And I'd always give her $20, and she was bigger than I am. And I got to thinking, I said, she's eating somewhere. And I said, this $20 I'm giving her, I don't know if she's going around and getting it from everybody. But she always tells me she's going to pay me back, and she never did. So I told her one day, I said, ma'am, are you got a route that you're running? And sure enough, she did have a route she was running. But I just felt that, I felt like it was a need there, you know. So, and that's the same way of being. Thank y'all all for coming out tonight. I know it's a busy, we got work tomorrow and everything, and thank you for coming out. I want to thank Lisa for doing the MC in here tonight. I want to thank Mac. If Mac does anything, it's always good. You know what I mean? It's always just, he's going to make it happen right. Mac and I were in business 7-8 years together. Never had an argument, except over the air conditioning unit. And I would want it on 75 and Mac, or 65, and Mac would want it on 72. So Mac could change it to 72 before we were in a business meeting, and he'd go out of the room, and I'd change it back to 75, or vice versa, you know, whatever it was. But I'd switch it, and he'd come in, switch it back, and I'd switch it. So that was the only real cross words we had in the 7 or 8 years. And him and Donna are great friends, and Sandy Bradley, I want to thank you for helping, and Allison, thank you for all you've done to make this night go off in a great way. It's been a great night. Great night. Thank you all again. Okay? And if I was a horse, they would euthanize me because I got to get knee surgeries this week. So.
He's getting his 19th knee replacement in a week. How many surgeries has he had? 18 or 19. See? I'm not making it up. So pray for him. October 6th, did you tell me? October, okay, 15th, something, a couple weeks. If you're the praying kind, pray. Okay, a couple things we need to do for some housekeeping. First, any of the graduates from the Exodus Project that are here with us tonight, we would love to honor you. Tony Wiggins, I know, is wearing his first suit tonight. He was, Todd, he was in the video. And where is he? Did he scoot out? There he is. Drop those clothes off, right. Everyone has something in their closet. You've got the Amazon app on your phone. You've already ordered something to replace the suits that you're not going to wear. Well, somebody wants to wear those. So it's Steve Landers at the store in Colonel Glenn. Drop off men's and women's clothing that are suitable for any type of job interview. That's real important. Let's band together and let's do that that way. And the other way is to give. I went ahead and filled out my card while I was sitting there. Allison, how do we want to put them back on the table? Check out there. So this is a time to go ahead. They'll take your credit card, trading beads, fur pelts, I mean, just about anything. And when you go out there to check out, don't forget to get one of Steve's books. Buy that. You can get, of course, the glass that's on the table. We're trying to raise money tonight, folks. We're not here just being cute and looking at fake flowers. We're here to raise some money. What else do we have? Yeah, get the book, and those are out there as well, right? Thank you so much for being here. Remember Exodus Project in your prayers, in your end of year giving, and give, give, give. Thanks for having me.